Good morning, everyone. I am happy to see a large number of posts relating to the topics presented in this week, and in particular on OER topics. And I will be delighted to answer your questions in case there are doubts. More importantly, the discussion between you is a lot more important in a course like this, and I am happy to see that. I have already given a large number of questions that you can answer during the lab session this afternoon. I believe that all of them can be done in 1.5 hours. In case some of you cannot complete, you become passionate about some topic, you want to explore further, that is perfectly okay too. You don't need to submit any assignment, you don't need to complete anything, but I have given a hint of what all can be done using the material that I presented. And I will also give more detailed assignments for later use. It could take quite a bit of your time, for example, organizing workshops for your students and so on. I will present them later. You can continue to do them even after the course is over. If you need help with those, our TAs will help you either in the creation of tutorials, dubbing of tutorials, or conducting a workshop using English spoken tutorials, or some people have said that they want to go through Sanskrit dubbed spoken tutorials, some others said Kannada dubbed spoken tutorials. You are most welcome to use them as well, and our team will be there to help you. With that, I would like to get started.
Sir, actually my question is not regarding like your content. I have just concern, and it is not my concern, but there are so many participants in our RC center as well as in this course. We have this concern regarding like a peer assessment. Sir, continuously we are monitoring that people are not doing their job seriously, and because of that we are suffering, who are making like really hard work for making our assignment, just for example our like web page and everything. And sir, after putting all this thing on even your discussion forum, we are not getting any satisfactory answer from the IIT staff, and every time we just get answer is like that the NE2 is assignment is going to be considered, but this is consistently happening for all the assignments. So far we have solved 4 assignments, and then I think sir, it is really very disappointing. I don't know, I mean, how to deal, because it is discouraging us to do like efforts for it. I mean, peer assessment is so far, I mean, what we have observed is that thing is not successful in this case. So kindly please take some kind of like a steps towards that, and please try to do something regarding this thing. Otherwise, I mean, motivation for us is not like in a proper way, I mean sir. So kindly address this issue.
Okay, I will answer it as follows. Although there is no peer assigned assessment in my part, we are learning some of these methods, you as well as us, okay? And there is quite a bit of learning involved, not only us, the world over, everybody is in the learning process. And given our limited time and effort that we can spend on this work, because we have only 24 hours, for example, I have been answering all the questions in the discussion forum for week 8, and I sleep at 12 o'clock, I have to get up once again early in the morning to answer the questions, okay? The answers have to be meaningful, correct. I cannot give arbitrary answers, it has to go to so many people. So in view of that, the limited time that we have to spend properly. One of the things we are trying to do, every instructor, is trying to get a working answer. We don't want to give just one answer. Somebody said that this person has not given proper assignment, proper answer. I can go and check every one of them, but I won't have sufficient time. Instead, we should actually look at systemic solution. How to prevent this? Maybe you just change one rule, the whole thing will change. So I would want you to, instead of just talking about it is not being done properly, I would want you to give suggestions. Change this rule, add this rule, remove this rule, okay? And that will be a lot more helpful. We are looking in that direction. We are looking at research papers that are coming out. Our ET group is also working in this area doing research. We have close to 25 people who are doing PhD. So these are new areas. In any new area, we can do two things. One is to say, we will do the peer assessment only later, after we know the answer. In which case, many courses of this type cannot be offered. How do we grade you? There are 4,000 of you. We don't have so many people to grade. So, shall we postpone until we know the answer? Or do we get along? We get started. Find answers to whatever we know right now. Give grades to the best extent possible using the knowledge that we already have. So, these are the two options. When we went for nationwide 1000 teacher training program that Professor Fatak did, that was a great jump, because we were doing QIP courses for only 30 people at a time. So we decided to go for 1000 people. That is equivalent to 30 courses, in some sense 30 years, right? Should we have stopped because some methods were not known? Should we have waited for the perfection of the method? As a matter of fact, I would say that unless you run them, you don't really understand some of the issues. So we have no option but to get on with whatever we have, using whatever knowledge we have, using whatever imperfections we have. That's the only way we can make progress. Okay, I hope I have answered it. I don't want to answer this any further, because there are other people who are working in this area, like Professor Fatak, Professor Sahana Murthy, and so on. They will come up with answers. Okay, I do not want to answer any more questions on peer assessment in this session. I think I have answered it to the extent I can. Okay, I would suggest that you talk to other people. If you have further questions on this, please talk to them. Thank you. Birla Institute, yeah, please go ahead.
Good morning, sir.
Yeah.
Kindly clarify, what is difference between a spoken tutorial and a screencasts?
Yeah, good question. Let me repeat the question. What is the difference between a screencast and spoken tutorial? Spoken tutorial has been created using screencast methodology. Screencast is a method, just like you have video recording, you have screencast. What is screencast? It records the screen. Okay. Now, if you give a running commentary along with that, then you have the audio also. It is possible to have screencast without audio at all. As a matter of fact, in the year 2007, when our method started, the spoken tutorial was created first time. There were many tutorials without an audio explanation. There were just videos. And so we thought that let us give audio in all our creations. So we did screencast, we added our voice. Because you don't see our face, we called it spoken tutorial, right? Whereas you see my face now. Whereas in the spoken tutorial, in fact, in all spoken tutorials, you don't see anybody's face. We called it spoken tutorial. We also decided to dub them into all 22 languages for the benefit of our children who may be weak in English. Okay? We have a lot of children who are very smart, but not necessarily fluent in English. So we said that let us offer our tutorials into their languages also. How do we do this? By dubbing only the spoken part. Okay, of course, one can ask, what about the screen? You have everything in English. We said, let it be in English because our children want jobs in Indian industry, and to get a job, a knowledge of English is very useful. Let them use normal computers. Let them not demand Devanagari keyboard, because how many people with Devanagari keyboard experience will get jobs in IT industry? How many of them will get job in TCS, Infosys, Wipro, and so on? Because they have to use normal computers, they have to use normal keyboard, normal screen. So we said we will dub only the spoken part. Everything else will be in English. Because we dub the spoken part once again into all 22 languages, the spoken word is extremely important to us. So we called it spoken tutorial, right? Spoken tutorials have three important things that an ordinary screencast may not have. What is it? First of all, spoken tutorials are created for self-learning. We go through so much effort. You have seen the processes involved in creating spoken tutorial. So we put in so much effort that it is suitable for self-learning. No other screencast created tutorial claims this, but we claim it. That is one major difference. Second difference, we dub them into all 22 Indian languages. Nobody else can claim that. Ours is the largest collection of IT and software and whatever you see on the computer available as instructional material in Indian languages. We have about 5,600 tutorials. We have 120 in Sanskrit. We have a very large number, for example, in Nepali, close to 400 in all our 22 languages. So how many other projects can claim this? This is the second one. The third one, which is equally important, is that if you go through YouTube, you see lots of videos, but then it is very difficult for you to download them. I'm not saying that you cannot, but ordinary people like me cannot download. Of course, there are experts at IIT who always say, I know how to download, but then I have to go through extra effort to download. On the other hand, understanding the difficulty of our students in getting bandwidth. Most of our children don't have access to bandwidth. Just imagine in a lab, 40 people learning, let's say, C tutorials, and everybody is downloading directly from the internet, directly streaming. What will happen to bandwidth? In fact, I would claim that even in IIT, which has quite a good bandwidth, our system will collapse. 40 people downloading, streaming in parallel videos, right? It will happen in every college, okay? Where as a result, YouTube-based videos, which are also created using screencast, are not suitable for instructional purposes. Of course, the other problem is in YouTube, you have them in a haphazard manner. Whereas we say, here is the specific sequence, we even number them 1, 2, 3, and we go to any one, we say, look, this is the prerequisite. And we say, open this video, we want you to use the side by side method. Side by side method means, supposing in the video I open a file, you should also be able to open. Otherwise, how can you practice side by side? I am telling that every command demonstrated in the video should be done by you, should be reproduced by you. So I want to plot a file. So I need a data file. So I open the data file. I don't give the data file to you. How do you open it? So how is it possible, let's say, in YouTube videos? So here we said that it must be available. In fact, I showed a video called side by side method. I strongly encourage you to see that. It tells you about the pedagogy involved. That pedagogy we have, you take an arbitrary screencast created video, it may not be available. So these are all the differences between spoken tutorial and ordinary screencast. So screencast is a methodology. Anybody can create it. I would say that our project is quite different. We do use screencast, right? Every spoken tutorial is created using screencast, but every screencast cannot be a spoken tutorial. Does it answer your question?
Yes, sir. Thanks.
Welcome.
Good morning, sir. I am Venkatesh from MIT Aurangabad College. So I have one question. We are doing a lot of activities through the ICT blended learning process. We are having more than 3,000 people, we are registered in this domain. We are working from the past 2 months onwards. So what is my question means, how we can focus in the research oriented activities, it will be very helpful for individual, because most of the people, they are doing the research work. If it is, we are forming some group based upon these activities on the domain expert. If at the same time IIT Bombay is helping some kind of research oriented activities for them, it will be the more helpful for me. How you can support for this in research oriented activities through this ICT blended learning?
Yeah, that's a good question. The question is, most of the participants who are in this course are interested in research, whether this activity can help in their research, whether they can participate in the research, let's say OER research, MOOCs research, and so on. And this question is from Marathwada Institute of Technology. I am happy to receive this question. As I mentioned earlier, IIT Bombay has an education technology program wherein we offer only PhD degrees. We are, of course, there is a lot of demand to join this PhD program from prospective faculty members, prospective students who are currently faculty members. We have slowed down on PhD admissions mainly because we don't have too many faculty members in the education technology program. We have only one full-time faculty member, that is Professor Sahana Muthi. Now Professor Sridhar Iyer has joined, he has been deputed by computer science to go into education technology. And we are looking for more faculty members to join this program. And I would like to point out, we don't get enough good candidates who can become faculty members at IIT Bombay, because we have some norms and so on, some requirements and so on. So we are looking for outstanding candidates who can join as faculty members. So this can happen only if all of you, the whole country does a lot more research in this area. If a lot of people do research, then some research will be outstanding and some researchers will be outstanding, and we would have more people to choose from that lot as our faculty members, who can of course promote this activity even more vigorously, who can admit many more people as PhD candidates. So in view of that, it's an excellent question. So I would say that one thing is to look at our education technology research. There are people whose names are listed. I would say that I would urge you to go to the ET webpage and look at the profiles of faculty members who are listed there. Look at some of their papers. Go through the papers. For example, I shared one paper with you on CS101's effectiveness study with a low cost affordable laptop. Okay, so you can actually see how a study is conducted, what kind of, you know, if you want to write a paper, then there is a reason for doing that study, which is typically explained in the introduction, background work. Then you have research questions. What are the questions we want to address, and how do we go about conducting that study? How does one ask questions? How does one prepare a questionnaire so that it is acceptable? For example, in the paper that I shared with you, there are two tables. There is one table called likes, another table called dislikes. But I didn't ask them separately. These are the reasons you like this computer, tick, 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 tick. These are the reasons why you dislike the computer, tick, tick, tick. I didn't do that. Because the problem is, what is the guarantee that they actually read the question and answer? What if they say strongly disagree, tick, 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 strongly agree, tick, 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 without even reading? That kind of answer is not acceptable. So you need a mechanism to find out whether the answer is reliable, whether people who are answering the questionnaire are giving consistent answers. So how do we do that? We mix the two. So for example, because of this reason, I like it, agree, strongly agree, disagree, whatever. Similar, next one will say, because of this reason, I hate this computer. So these are mixed. So if somebody says ticks everywhere, then you know that that person is, you know, not serious, throw that answer away. So these are some methods that you must follow to make sure that the questionnaire itself is consistent. Okay, so you can see in every step of that work there are issues and you need to address them. Okay, if you want to work in this area, research methodology is a course that is offered. If I am not mistaken, IIT Bombay has already made it available. We have already offered it through IIT Bombay X. I would suggest that you go through this. If you want to participate in IT kind of work, if you want to do in, let us say, OER creation and validation, that it is good, not good. I told you about creation of spoken tutorials, creation of textbook companions, lab migration. Okay, I would want you to become passionate about, for example, open source software, because it allows you to play around with it, it allows you to open it, it allows you to update it, it allows you to, whereas if it is proprietary, everything happens, you don't have to do anything, you click it, it just happens, you just use it. It's like saying, it's a car you have, right, but you can't, you shouldn't open the hood. If you want to be a mechanic, you should be able to open the hood and go through it, take it out, put it back and things like that. So if you want to say, I want to get into this area, I want to do OER, I want to create content, I want to work with open source software, then you must have access to software, you must be able to put things together, you must be able to modify things to so that it meets your requirement. So there are many things that you need to do. I would strongly encourage you to do open source software. Okay, I don't know whether I have answered your question, but please engage with us, please find out what our people are doing, try to read, and then if you have specific question, you know, supposing you say, you ask a faculty member and say, look, I went through this paper, I have this specific question, can you please answer? Somebody will answer. But supposing you say, oh, I don't know what education technology is, can you please help me? Nobody will answer, right? Because you have to show interest. You have to take initiative. Please take initiative. Somebody will answer. I hope I have answered your question.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Good morning, sir. Myself is Dr. Deepalakshmi from Kalasalingam University. We are representing the remote center, Tyaraja College of Engineering. I already raised a question in the forum about the way to use the OER, that is Open Educational Repository. I am basically from CS background. So I've seen that for a C programming book, you have created examples, everything using the Scilab. So with the help of the Scilab coding, how can I teach the C coding and how much this will be useful to the students of computer science department?
That is a good question, Dr. Deepalakshmi from Kalasilingam University and who is attending Madurai Tyagaraja College. It's a very nice question. How does one use OER in general and how to use the Scilab textbook companion or whatever it is for C programming? I would at the outset point out that for C programming or whatever you want to achieve in a programming course, Scilab is not necessarily the best programming environment. Mainly because it is created for numerical computation. So let us see why Scilab was created. It was created by a person by name Professor Clive Moeller when he was a faculty member in New Mexico State University in the US. He wrote it for the first time in Fortran in late 70s. Okay, as a matter of fact, when I was a PhD student in 80-81, I downloaded, because those were available, this Fortran code was available, I downloaded, compiled and ran on PC80. PCs had just come, I ran them on PC80, they worked perfectly. But Professor Klee Moller used to ask, when I am teaching matrices in my class, I write AX equals B and everybody understands. Why is it the computer does not understand? Why is it I have to tell the computer that A is of double precision, that it should have so much space, okay, and I have to do row times column. Why should I explain all this? Is it not possible for me to come up with an environment that will handle all this automatically? So he wrote this, it was created with government funds, and so it was made available for everybody free of cost. So it was mainly created for matrix multiplication, matrix manipulation. In fact, it has been optimized for vector arithmetic. Okay. So if you have lot of computation, for example, if you want to do numerical analysis, you want to teach linear algebra, it's a great course. It's very popular in most engineering departments, electrical engineering, image processing, chemical engineering, control purposes and so on, it is highly apt. Whereas for programming per se, I would say Python is a very good programming environment. So I would say, is it possible to redo the entire Scilab textbook companion you saw into Python? Okay. Another outstanding language is Julia, J-U-L-I-A. Julia is a great programming language. You can read about it. Now that you have asked this question, let me give also a slightly different answer. This may also answer the previous question. For example, somebody asks, look, this video is already available, how do I use it in my class? Okay. There is a, you have come across, I am sure that you have been taught this flip method. I think in the early part of this course, somebody taught you a flip method. I have used the flip method for many years now. I think it is I have actually done it 7 years, 5 times for my postgraduate control course, digital control. And I followed the same method twice to my undergraduates. First time I did it for 60 students, second time I did this flip method for 130 students, okay, in which I used my own video recorded courses as a study material. In digital control, I created videos, I left them. Similarly, my other course, which is process control, undergraduate level first control course, also I created set of lectures and gave it to them. And I told the students, you must read and come to the class. Okay. Of course, there is a question of students doing more work. If you ask them, I have 3 hours of lecture I have created, I have left them, you read the 3 lectures and come to the class also for 3 hours. Then the students complain, do you want me to do 3 plus 3, 6 hours? Whereas in other courses, I have to spend only 3 hours. In your course, I have to spend 6 hours. This is unfair. I don't want to do it. So as a result, we optimized the method. What I can do is I can share that paper. In fact, I would say it is a successful paper, successful research study, which appeared as a paper in an IEEE international conference. I would share that with you, because unless you take care of this particular perception of students, namely, they don't have to do much more work than other courses. For example, there was in fact a study conducted, if I am not mistaken, at Texas A&M University for nursing students. For nursing students, they did a flipped method, and of course, at the end of the course, they found that everybody had done well. It was performance was a lot better than other courses. Then they also asked questions, do you like this course? Most of them said they hated the course. because it was too much work. In the US, it might work because they pay through their nose to study. In India, our students will stop coming to class. They will come to class, they will do something else, because they say anyway you are asking us to do too much work. So this flipped method will not work if there is cooperation from students. You need to come up with proper management techniques as well for this method to succeed. So I have that paper, I will share it with you. So this flipped method is available to all of you. You take any topic, a course is available in NPTEL. I assume that of course it is available mostly for engineering, there are science methods also, but then I gave you some more links in the discussion pages. I gave you links of e-Pathshala, it was created by UGC. I also gave links to web pages created by CEC. If it is not available, if your topic is not available, but it is available in, let's say, OCW, let's say if it is available in Stanford for everyone, it is available in OpenGL, you are welcome to use them. You can always say that for this topic, go and read, I am not going to teach, but I am going to conduct a test, right? Nobody can prevent you from doing it, right? You conduct the class, you ask them and you say that based on that, I am going to give 5 marks. All autonomous colleges can do that, all autonomous universities can do that. Please go with a proposal to your vice chancellor and say that, look, I have done this, I believe this will work, the students will actually like it, they will do better, okay. As a matter of fact, I would like to inform you about a quiz app that one of my colleagues here, Professor Bhaskar, Professor Bhaskaran and Professor Kameshwari, there are two faculty members in computer science at IIT Bombay, they have come up with an app called, I think it is Safe Quiz or something like that. What it does is, you have a multiple choice question, you have a multiple choice question, students can answer them through their mobile. Basically the software takes control of the mobile and they can only do answering, okay. The students like it, of course there are some people who do it with paper. In my flipped class method, what I used to do was, you have to go through 3 hours of video, but I am going to meet you only once in a week. You have to go through this 3 hours, come to the class once a week, but I am going to conduct a quiz and I am going to give you marks, okay. And these marks will count towards your overall grade, okay. And there were 10 questions, every week 10 questions. In fact, I had done this 10 times. So 10 times weekly quiz, 20 minutes MCQ, and many of them use this Safe Quiz app created by Professor Bhaskaran and Kameshwari, okay. In fact, I can share that quiz app with you in case you want to use it in your class. So you can innovate the way you teach. In fact, this can be very close, all of you teach. What can happen is, in fact I keep telling, there are some people who are outstanding teachers, who are born teachers, okay, but there are very few, less than 1%, okay. But if you use these methods, even an ordinary teacher can provide outstanding teaching. May not be as good as born teachers, there are some people, but they are only 1%, but look at the other 99%. We can also teach well. I am not a great teacher, but if I have done lot of work, what these ICT based methods do is, they allow you to do lot of prior work. You write slides, so you do not make mistakes, right. Sometimes your pronunciation is not okay, does not matter, you keep saying it and then your video cameraman cut off all the wrong pronunciation, you produce a good video lecture. So these methods allow you to become good teachers, if not outstanding teachers. Even an ordinary person can become a good teacher, good enough for all practical purposes, and these teachers can deliver good courses anywhere in the world, in any university in the world, right. It will train you. So these methods allow you to get better. Only thing required is, are you willing to do the work? If you are willing to do the work, if you are willing to do research, if you are willing to do research, that means you are willing to do the work. If you are willing to do the work, then it's fine. Everybody can become a good teacher. So there are a lot of things you can do. Everyone, I suggest, do a flipped method. Everybody, at least for one class, that I would suggest as a beginning, first step, baby step for doing research in this area. I would share my flipped class method. I would encourage you to go through it. And if you have a specific question on that paper, I'll be happy to answer. Remember to put them in week 8 discussions. Thank you, Deepalakshmi. Yeah, you have more questions? Go ahead, please.
About the fuzzy laptop, now it is available for 10,000 rupees. Suppose if I want to purchase it, whom should I contact in IIT? Is it possible for a bulk purchase, and is there a guarantee period for that?
Good question. I have this laptop in front of me. I had given a link, tiny URL in one of the discussions where I have asked you to give details. In fact, I have asked you questions like, when do you think that your people will be interested? How many people do you think will be interested? If there is some question I have missed out, you can write in this text box. Yes, it comes with warranty. It is rupees 10,000, including first year's services. In a place like Madurai, I am pretty sure that service is available. In all major cities, I am pretty sure services can be made available. If a large number of computers are bought in an institute, then it becomes easy to provide services. Okay, so supposing, let's say 200-300 computers are sold, then there is enough money kept aside for servicing. Somebody can even be, you know, paid salary out of that money. Okay, so I'm not saying that 200-300 should be sold in that college. Even neighbors can buy it, right? Your secretaries can buy it. Your bus drivers can buy it. All that they have to do is the numbers are sold and they have contributed to that. If there is a problem, they can bring it to that center. It could be bought by your neighboring school, which says, I want to give this computer to all my teachers. I am unable to give it to all my students, but can I give it to my teachers? So it can be done. So it is available right now. And as a matter of fact, you know, if a college, if we know that a college is thinking about purchasing a large number of computers, we will be more than happy to provide further assistance. If there are specific questions, I'll be happy to answer them.
Thank you so much for the information you have provided, sir. In fact, regarding the flipped classroom, myself and my friend Dr. Ramlakshmi, we have adopted this concept for 10 topics in the course Object-Oriented Programming in C++. And thank you so much to IIT Bombay for this wonderful effort, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. You're most welcome.
This is G. Balram, Assistant Professor, CSE Department. College name Anura Group of Institution, Remote Center 1161. And, I have not attempted two quizzes in IIT Bombay X portal because of confusion between Moodle and IIT Bombay X. Two portals are there. So, can you kindly put quizzes and assignment in one portal, if it is possible?
Question is from Anura Group of Institutions from Rangareddy. And because of two different portals, you know, you missed two quiz. Can both of them be put in one? My gut feeling is, I don't deal with this because I'm just a person who delivers this course. But my gut feeling is that it can't be done. It can't be done for various reasons. We need to have both. This was already raised. And we have agreed that maybe we can keep the same deadline for both. So you should remember to put them. That's what I believe somebody would answer. If they can merge the two, I'll be more than happy. Of course, you'll also be equally happy. But I don't know the answer to this question, whether it can be replaced by just one. That I don't know. But dates, I'm pretty sure, can be kept the same. That feedback will go to the organizers. Thank you.
Sir, one thing, whatever previously we attended the workshops, we have used only Moodle, better one, better choice, I think.
Yeah, so the question is, we used only Moodle, when we had our T10 KT, this is, you know, the way we are doing live, okay. But the whole world seems to be going towards MOOCs, okay. And as a result, MOOCs means there is a tangible content created, the discussions properly recorded, and short clips put, discussions for them, assignments for them. So in that sense, this MOOCs seems to be a different way of packaging the same thing for apparently better efficacy, and people can study at any time. Whereas T10 KT is something that you have to be there at that time, okay. And it also requires a lot of bandwidth, it also requires a lot of machinery. For one thing, T10 KT means people want TADA, right. Whereas in MOOCs, we do not have to give TADA. I am not complaining, but then the taxpayers are complaining, the ministry is complaining, when MOOCs can be run without any expenditure, why IIT Bombay is demanding so much money for TADA. As a matter of fact, our T10 KT project, more than half the money was earmarked for TADA, that was 95 crore. So the government says 95 crore is a lot of money, that is of course for 15 courses to train 150,000 teachers through T10 KT. So the government says that that money can be used for several other important things, let us do it just by MOOCs, because it does not cost anything. And not only that, lot of people are doing research on improving MOOCs, the learning will be better, it can be translated to other languages, it can be shared with overseas countries, it can be offered again and again. So there are many advantages in MOOCs, that we should go towards MOOCs. So we have IIT Bombay X. Of course, we strongly believe that we should continue with our live interaction also. That is why, even though we do not have it fully for this course, we do offer it. And in fact, it is because of the T10 KT, we are able to talk to each other in person, although at a distance, right. We can see each other, you can see what shirt I am wearing, I can see how many people are sitting in your classroom, and how many people are sitting in the front row, how many are in the back row, how many ladies are there, how many ladies are asking questions, so on and so forth. We are able to find out all this, and of course you also get to see whether we start the thing in time and whether our mic is okay, a lot of nice things, how do we field the questions and how do you ask the questions. So there is a lot of learning that happens in a synchronous interaction. What we are doing here is synchronous interaction, as opposed to, let us say, IIT Bombay X, MOOCs, which are mostly asynchronous, okay. T10 KT was completely synchronous, but it was very expensive. So we are going towards mostly asynchronous through MOOCs, but we have little bit of synchronous that allows us to see each other at least once in a while, okay. So because of these reasons, we need to have two, because IIT Bombay X has its own way to assess, do projects or whatever, and then Moodle has its own. Moodle was used in T10 KT. Until all the features become available in IIT Bombay X, I assume that you have to do both. I hope I have answered your question. Thank you.
Good morning, sir. My name is Sukesh from RCID 1278, SDM Institute of Technology, Ujire. I have a question on OER. Actually, a lot of resources are available in open source. Like, how to guarantee, or who will guarantee the quality of this educational resources?
So, good question. This question is about who will guarantee the quality of the courses available through an OER. So, I will give an extreme example. You would have heard of Wikipedia. Wikipedia has millions of pages, all created by contributors, okay. Now, it is proven In fact, it got proved about, if I am not mistaken, about 3 to 4 years ago, that any mistake that comes into Wikipedia gets corrected within 9 minutes. Any mistake in any one of the millions of pages gets corrected within 9 minutes. Why? Because there are so many people who are also checking, who are going through. Because there are so many people using it, every page gets used, every page gets corrected, every page gets commented upon, and so on. So that is a example that we should always keep in mind. That should be the method that we should go for. And if lot of people use it, comment on it, correct it, OER will become better. Okay. Of course, we are far off from that ideal, because Wikipedia is an exception. It's an unusually good OER. That's the reason on any topic, if you say you do a search, whatever be the search engine, whether it is Google, whether it is Microsoft, whether it is Yahoo, you will see Wikipedia entry on the first page, no matter what topic it is. So it has reached that level of, and as a matter of fact, no other encyclopedia can come anywhere close to this open source software, Wikipedia. Okay? So this should be the ideal, this should be the goal for all the OER projects. So in the meantime, so what do? We have to be careful. We have to be careful about the veracity, correctness of the material taught in that. And of course, if you take it from reputed people, hopefully it will be good. But even then, take it with a little bit of pinch of salt, that there could be something wrong. If you are told, unfortunately, in some states, there are no entrance exams for higher studies, and it is based only on state board marks, and the students are, you know, told to study just from the book, reproduce the book in your exam, you will get 200 on 200, you will get admission in medical colleges, you will get admission in engineering colleges. In fact, in some states, children unfortunately don't even study the 11th grade portion. 11th grade students come, within 1 month, 11th grade is finished, and they study the 12th grade book for 2 years. Why? They want the children to get 200 on 200. So once they go to the class, go to the engineering college, you know, many people fail. Many people fail because in engineering college and professional colleges, that method no longer works. Okay? So these children are told to study from the book, not to ask questions. The faculty members also will say, no, no, don't ask questions. You must mug up. You must be able to reproduce everything in the book. Now, if we take that attitude, obviously OER is not going to work. You should ask, is this correct? You should verify. Not only should we ask this question, we should also ask our children. Why can't we say that doesn't matter, you don't get admission, doesn't matter, but I want you to understand the topic. I want to teach the 11th standard portion. I want you to study that. Why don't we say that? So the answer to your question is, OER topics could have some mistakes. You should ask questions. Go to reputed people, then such occurrences of mistakes could be less, although not necessarily, there is no guarantee that no mistake at all. Okay, I hope I have answered your question.
That means we need to be very careful even in what information is right, what information is wrong. We need to verify it all the time, and probably it will be taking little more time in our efforts.
Yes, I think it is worth it. Even from a book, even in the book, standard book, there is a theorem proof. You have to understand the proof and ask, are all the steps in the proof correct? Right? If you think that some step is wrong, then you know, hey, you know, this fellow, you know, I have to be a little careful with this book. I am talking about standard textbooks. Of course, we have many local textbooks floating around, which are created through copy paste. Of course, you have to check. You have to check the correctness. So, obviously, if you go for top of the line book, then you know it is a great book, right? Whereas a book has been created in your own college, your own university, so that your students will get marks, you be careful, check it, right?
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you.
I have one question regarding this solutions are available to open source. So, if students are also able to see that solution, they won't try to write the code, they'll just simply copy that code. So, how it will benefit the students just as a
Okay. So, good question. The question is, if answers are also given, students just copy them and answer them and they are not going to learn. What do we do? So, it is a trade-off that we should give a little bit so that they do get confidence. It is like saying that we have to give model answers. I follow two methods. I will just explain to you. I do not know whether it is implementable in the university system, but I always do that. One thing is, if you look at our textbook companions, let us take Scilab textbook companion, we have 535 books available right now. These have code for only solved problems. We have not given code for any unsolved problem. So, we ask the students, you please do that, okay, and verify whether it works. That is one thing. The other thing that I always ask in all my exams, how do I find out? I always try to find out whether a student has understood the subject. How do we find that out? I have one method. I always ask some questions for about 20 to 30% of the portion on topics that I have not taught in the class. Outside the portion, I ask 20 to 30% questions. Okay? If people have understood everything that I have taught, then understood, then they can extend that knowledge to solve a new problem. Okay, where is this new problem? It is on a topic that I have not taught. Okay? And of course, I show them the steps. Do this, what do you find? Then do these calculations, you can show that this is equal to this, and so on and so forth. It is all given in a more or less a learning mode, and only students who have understood the previous ones can do this. So, in other words, it is, at least for me, it is very easy to set questions that help me find out whether the students have understood. It does not matter if they have copied, it does not matter, but at least for this 30%, I can find out. Okay, only students who have understood can get this answer correct, and those students who have mugged up the book for 2 years in order to get 200 on 200 in state board exams cannot, they will get 0 in this 30. Okay, so I can release it, so you can also release it, but you ask some extra questions. Next year you release that new question as a world question and you ask one more question, you can go on coming up with new questions every year. There are infinite number of new questions to ask. That is my answer.
Good morning, sir. I am Smith from LDRP Institute of Technology and Research, Gandhinagar. My question is related to the textbook companion project. I am from a background of electronics and communication. So, I have gone through few textbooks, the standard textbook projects they have done. Okay, and I have gone through the Scilab code also, and we are using at our university Scilab. So, I tested few of the codes. So, most of them are working, that is not, but I found that it can be made much simpler also, so that student can take it in Scilab. In our university, we have found that our students are very afraid of this Scilab. So, earlier we thought they knew about MATLAB, that is why, but later on, when they got into this first semester itself, we started to make them to use Scilab, but still they are afraid of it. So, I think that some textbook companion project Scilab code is similar. So, I would like to contribute towards this. So, for that what I have to do, I just want a guidance from you, as well as the second part, that how to make our student feel that Scilab, they are very much afraid of Scilab compared to MATLAB. We have a license copy of MATLAB at our university. So, but we want to promote Scilab, and few of our faculty have done lab migration project also in the year in the field of probability theory and random process, image processing, applied mathematics. So we want to promote it, but our university students are very afraid of Scilab. So how to remove that? That's my question.
Okay. So there were actually many questions. One is, so this is from LDRP College of Engineering in Gujarat. So there were many questions. I'll name some of them. One is, students are afraid of Scilab. How to remove the fear? That is number one. Number two, how to contribute to Scilab textbook companion, and possibly a third question, how to contribute to lab migration. For second and third, I will answer first. It is given in our web page. I showed some web pages. If you go and see Scilab textbook companion opening page, at the bottom it says there are instructions. How does one contribute? Just go and see that all the information is given. Okay. If you still have questions, you please put it as a question in this discussion forum for this week, and if there are specific questions, I'll be able to answer. But all the information is available both for textbook companion and lab migration. It also tells different steps in that. It also tells the honorarium available. All kinds of things in all gory details are provided there. You can do this for textbook companion and also lab migration. One of the important things is, if you want to remove the fear, first of all, I don't see any reason why there should be a fear to use Scilab. In fact, if you ask me to use MATLAB, I'll be scared because I don't know the commands, because I have not been using MATLAB for 7-8 years, right? Whereas Scilab is what I use every day, and so I am very comfortable. So the reason why they are comfortable, they are not comfortable in Scilab, why they are scared, is that they use MATLAB most of the time, and only in one course they have to use Scilab, they get scared. So what I did at the beginning, I said that, look, I don't have access to official copy of MATLAB. My TAs also don't have access to official copy of MATLAB. As a result, if you submit any assignment in MATLAB, we cannot grade it. How do I grade it? I need to have a copy of MATLAB. I don't have one. How can I grade it? So use Scilab, I can grade it. So I made it compulsory. Okay. Students used to complain, you are being a dictator. I can always say, I could have immediately said, show me that you used official copy of MATLAB to create this assignment, then I will determine whether I should grade or not. I could have said that. Because how many people, how many students use official copy of MATLAB? That's the first question that every one of you should ask. Is it the right thing? Should they be using, you know, illegal means? That's the first question that we should ask. Do they have MATLAB in their home? You may have official copy in the college. How many copies are there? How many students are there? Can all the people use it simultaneously? These are some questions you can ask. Okay. The second thing is, I would say more important, I would ask is, can our industry afford MATLAB? Do you know the cost of MATLAB to industry? It's extremely expensive. Many times, in fact, you won't even believe how expensive it is, right? So we are creating our engineers on MATLAB who cannot go and use it outside, right? It's a serious problem. It's like saying, I am teaching my students using a book which they cannot take outside my college compound, because MATLAB is very expensive. Similarly, for your maybe Cadence software, very expensive once again. Maybe Fluent for fluid mechanics, once again, very expensive. You go on naming extremely expensive software packages. Why are we training our children on that? Whereas, I can load Scilab on this machine, this 10,000 rupee machine. It's preloaded. It comes preloaded with OpenFOAM. it comes preloaded with eSIM, it comes preloaded with Sage, Python and so on. We can make this available. This they can use legally anywhere, whether they are traveling, whether they are at home, or whether they go to even a small company that cannot afford an expensive software. Why are we teaching our children on things that they cannot use in industry? Are we being responsible to the industry? Are we being responsible to small and medium scale enterprises by teaching in MATLAB? Some of these companies, if they use illegal software, they have to go to jail. Their companies will close down. By using expensive software in academia, we are being irresponsible to our society. We are not doing the right thing. Coming back to your first question, how do we improve the fear? You tell them use Scilab from now on, no MATLAB. There will be a fear for 2 days, 3 days. From next week onwards, you will see that they are all comfortable. I have 50 interns at IIT Bombay. They are all from different parts of the country. They are all working on Scilab backend. They are improving Scilab toolboxes. They are improving XCOS appearance. They are using Scilab for remote triggered labs. They are putting XCOS on the cloud. You come and tell them, are you scared? They will laugh at you. Okay. So the fear comes only because of lack of use. Please use. I want all of you to say, from today, I will start using Scilab. I will ask my students to use Scilab. I will accept MATLAB only if I know that they have used official copy of MATLAB. You take a vow like this, you will see that in 1 week, there will be no fears. Fears will be completely gone. Okay? Thank you.
I have a question regarding laptop. What is the definition of bulk according to you for purchase of or service of laptops?
The question is, what is meant by bulk purchase? I don't have a correct definition of it. I believe it is a few hundred to 300 is probably a bulk purchase. Basically, you just have to do the calculation, assuming that, let's say, 10% of the money is going to be kept for, let's say, you know, support. Okay, let's look at the second year onwards. Let's say 10% of the money is to be paid, so that means 1000 rupees per unit. Okay, how much of such money is to be collected so that somebody can be placed, their salary can be paid for, and then you can also bring in spare components. For example, your keyboard breaks, your you know, there is a crack somewhere, your USB doesn't work. I'm not saying that it is going to happen, but in any electronic device, such a thing can happen. And you may be an unfortunate person, so it may happen in your machine, while in 99 other machines, such a thing may not happen. So it's like an insurance that we are trying to build. You know, this is how this whole thing works. So you have to be realistic. If a person has to be kept, one room has to be given by your college, and this person is available, his salary can be paid, or if there are, you know, lot of people, maybe two people, so that it is, that service is available from early morning to late night. You know, there are various, I mean, it's a easy thing to calculate. So I don't know the answer, what is meant by bulk. I would say a few hundred units. Do you think your students may be interested?
Yeah.
Okay.
Can we have some idea about configuration of laptop?
Okay. So the question is about the configuration. It has 2 GB RAM, 32 GB NAND flash. So that is equivalent of hard disk. By the way, I have this Mac here. This also has NAND flash. Only thing is, it has lot more. It might have 128 GB or 256 GB, but then the price of that is 60,000 or 70,000. It's a lot more expensive. As a matter of fact, you may be surprised, in case any of you are thinking about buying a Mac, you will be surprised to know, in fact, I was shocked to know, that if the keyboard breaks, then you have to replace the whole thing. That costs about 17,000 rupees, 17,000, just to change the keyboard. So I said, you know, it's crazy. Why should I do that? I can buy this new laptop for 10,000. Should I pay 17,000 to replace this? It's a crazy thing. So this is an expensive proposition, right? As a matter of fact, I am switching to this low cost laptop when I want to move away from this MacBook Air. The main reason why I used to stay with, I have been using Mac was it used to create nice videos, because I create spoken tutorials. Look at my t-shirt, I'm wearing this spoken tutorial t-shirt. That's very important to me. I go and give demonstration. People ask, how do you create a tutorial? I record and then I give it. But then, as I demonstrated in one of the OERs, I created a spoken tutorial using this on LaTeX report writing, and it is no inferior to this machine. All that I had to do was to buy a 5000 rupee mic and fit it into this. It's an extra fitting that I need, but then I am not creating spoken tutorials all the time. I have the mic, 10 other people can use it, okay. So if I have, you know, two mics, the whole department can use it. So it's not a, you know, great expense, but it empowers this machine, right. So 32 GB NAND flash is what it has. Nowadays, of course, you get 32 GB SD card that works with mobile phone for 500 rupees. So your 32 GB becomes 64 GB. Of course, people could say, especially your students who download movies will say, well, even 64 GB is not good enough. I would tell them even 1 terabyte is not enough for them, because they can download lots of movies, they need lots of terabytes. Fine, you keep it as external, okay. But I believe that if you just want to do, you know, good academic work, 32 GB is good enough. At most, you need 64 GB, you just spend another 500 rupees, you have a great machine. Then you have 11.6 inch screen, you have two USB drives, one mini HDMI port. Of course, it has audio port, input output, it has a 10,000 mAh battery, the battery lasts a long time. It has a great graphics engine. I demonstrated that you can create 3D plots in Scilab very easily and simultaneously work with Blender, do animation, it moves very fast and so on. We can load it with almost any software. It's a complete Linux machine. Okay, if you have a specific question on any of the specifications, please let me know, I will answer that.
Can there be a detailed workshop to how to use Scilab for the newcomers?
The question is there a detailed workshop to newcomers of Scilab? The answer is yes, it is in the form of spoken tutorials. Spoken tutorials are created for self-learning. They are arranged in a particular sequence, and by learning that, people do active learning, because in spoken tutorial, they have to reproduce every command. They just don't come and listen and go to sleep. They have to reproduce every command. So if they reproduce every command in 25 spoken tutorials, that is good enough to start with. In addition, you have 535 textbook companions. In addition, you have quite a few lab migrations. So if people do all this, the next thing I would recommend is do a textbook companion. Take a standard textbook, code all the solved problems using Scilab, okay. So in case you have difficulty, look at the textbook companion in similar books. So for example, if you have a question on how do I do fast Fourier transform, remember I did a search. You do a search FFT, it gives you some 20 books that use FFT. In that, go through and find out a book in your area. Open that book, open that example, it tells you how to call FFT. So you know how to call FFT for your example, so just do that. So textbook companion creation is the easiest for a person who has gone through these spoken tutorial, okay. Then after that, the next question is, can I do lab migration, okay. We are happy to help you. You yourself can say, these are the 10 problems in my lab and I went through your lab migration solution. Hey, 7 problems are already answered. So now I have to migrate only 3 labs, only 3 problems, 3 lab sessions. Out of that, I know how to do 1. I need help on 2 more. Will you please help? I will say yes. I will tell my staff members, so look, here is a great college, out of 10 labs, they have themselves converted 8, please do this immediately. I will instruct, I will give an order to my staff members to attend to you and to help you immediately. So this is the way things progress. By doing this, what happens is you demonstrate your keenness in working with Scilab. On the other hand, if you say contact workshop, we used to do that. Some people used to invite, we are a great college, so many people are interested, 100 people are going to come, please come. Our people land there, there is nobody, nobody, cannot find anybody. You come, go to the lab, 10 people, and people come slowly, come on, we are not interested, we can't do this. There are 35,000 colleges in India, there are 5,000 engineering colleges in India, right? Many of them want to do Scilab and they want to invite us. It's not possible for us to go to all the colleges. But if we know that a college is making sincere progress, making a sincere attempt through the method that I described, then we go out of our way to help that college, to handhold. In fact, we make them also our partners. I hope I have answered your question.
Thank you so much, sir.
You're welcome.
So this is from 1301, Delhi Institute of Technology, Hubli, Karnataka. So my question is there. I conduct many spoken tutorial and after online, the students will be issued certificates. My question is, what is the weightage is given for the certificates when they attend interviews or placements?
Okay, good question. This is from KLE Institute of Technology from Hubli. What is the value of these certificates? So, there are two ways to conduct these online tests. One is the way that's available for exams like GATE, JEE and several competitive exams, where you will go to a center, something like TCS or some other center, and you pay a lot of money, out of which about 1000 to 1500 rupees will go from every student to this center, to this company. Okay? So if they do 10 such tests, then they will be poorer by something like 50,000 rupees because it costs some 5,000 rupees to do that. So this is one way to do that. The other way is to say what we have been doing in spoken tutorial, saying that it is free, don't have to pay anything, I don't want any money from you. Okay? Our project is funded by the government and I don't need to raise any money from you, and our objective is to share the knowledge with you, which we are ready to do without charging even a single paisa from you. Okay? Obviously, there is no money to give to the online proctoring place. Okay? Then given this scenario, so let me talk about the second one. First one is quite clear. If every student is willing to pay 5,000 rupees for a test and they do 10 such tests in a year, 50,000 rupees a year, if all your students want to do that, we can go for it. I am assuming that they don't want to do it. I am assuming that many students in the country cannot afford it. So we have to go for the second one. Okay. So what do? In our certificate, we put a line saying that this such and such person appeared in such and such online test. It was administered by IIT Bombay. It was proctored by such and such person from such and such college, so and so from KLE, for example. We state that name of the person who does the invigilation on the certificate. Okay? Tomorrow this person goes for an interview and that person, your student says, look, I appeared in a Scilab test and I passed. So they start asking questions in the interview and this person answers everything. Then they say, hey, this college is a good one. Okay, so let's get more people from that college. Or anytime somebody says, I'm giving my certificate, anybody from your college says, I've got a certificate in C, I've got a certificate in Java, I've got a certificate in Ruby, Perl, Python, whatever. Then the company says, hey, I want to go through it. I want to at least talk to that person. Whereas in your college or in some other college, this person says, hey, you know, I want my student to pass. I don't care whether they know it or not. I will allow them to copy. I'll allow them to keep books. Okay, and they also give a certificate to the company saying that I passed. They ask a question, it will become like Bihar, right? We know what happened in the college. Toppers, they didn't know the subject in which they were supposed to have scored marks. So immediately they will realize, that interview team will realize that this college is useless. The word will go around quickly that not to take any student from this college, not to talk to them, not to take them seriously. So whether to make full use of it or bring a bad name to you is in your hands. If you use it properly, there are colleges. I think Assam Don Bosco has given 10 marks of their weightage based on our online test. They invigilate it carefully. They make sure that the students do it properly. And I am sure the students there, their certificates that they have will have a lot of weightage. Whereas some other college where there is no invigilation will have no value, and simultaneously it will bring bad name to your college. I hope I have answered your question.
Thank you, sir.
Now, sir, I am from DKT Textile Engineering Institute, Chalakaranji. One request is there as far as spoken tutorials are concerned. There is a huge scope in Internet of Things as far as Linux platforms and Intel and different Raspberry Pi platforms are concerned. So, is it possible to develop some spoken tutorials on IoT?
So, good question. Thank you for that question. This question is from DKTE Society. They have been a good partner to IIT Bombay, to spoken tutorial project. So, the question now is Internet of Things, can we have spoken tutorials? We are going to make them. To start with, we are in the process of finalizing a set of spoken tutorials on Scilab Arduino. Scilab Arduino, we have a large number of tutorials that are going to be released. We have a big team that is working on hardware. In fact, let me tell you one interesting project that we are working on. This has to do with the planetarium. Okay, this project is aimed at improving the scientific thinking and improving the interest, scientific curiosity amongst students and especially school children, for example. So, what is this project? Look at this planetarium. You know, you would have gone to a planetarium show. It's typically about 45-minute show, where you go into this and there is a big dome and they turn the lights off and then you see the whole sky. Okay? And then you have somebody who comes and explains, here is the constellation, here is this star and so on and so forth. They talk about it. Okay? But it is available to very few people. So, we thought, why don't we build open planetarium using real sky, right? Using real sky. So, what is it? So, the idea is that there is this software called Stellarium, right? This Stellarium, it's an open source software. It knows all about the sky. It knows the entire configuration. It has billions of stars and so on and so forth, right? Now, this Stellarium knows, you know, supposing it is calibrated. So, you are in this particular city, you are in this country, or you are in the northern hemisphere, you are in the southern hemisphere, whatever it is. The moment you do a calibration, Stellarium knows exactly. Then, in the planetarium show that I talked about, there is a 45-minute script. Somebody says, let's go here and so on. Similar script can be created in Stellarium, right? Then, it will say, go to, let's see the star at this point. At this point means what? You have to look at it at a particular angle from wherever you are. So, we have a laser pointer and that is connected to a stepper motor, and this software gives instruction now change this. And then you see the light, of course, it will happen only in a dark sky. So it will not be seen in a cloudy sky, but in a dark sky, which is there most of the time, and in all small places. It may not be, sky is not visible in a big city like Mumbai or Chennai, but if you go 50 kilometers away, sky is dark and you can actually see the star, and then the spoken tutorial comes on, it tells the story in Marathi, it tells the story in Tamil, Hindi, Malayalam, Nepali, Kasi, Bodo and so on, and so, Urdu, Sanskrit, whatever language you choose, and then you have the thing, and then after that thing is done, it moves on, the script moves on, because it's a 45 minute script. So this whole thing, basically we have to come up with a circuit board, a stepper motor, laser pointer, it has to be interfaced with stellarium, and the whole thing has to be housed, and you know, we have to put it in a closed container, and the whole thing can be sold possibly for about 1,000 rupees, okay, and that will work with our low cost laptop. So every school can afford one, every school can afford one, any interested school can say, hey, tonight we are going to do a planetarium, okay. So people go with their dari, with their blanket, and they all lie down in a maidan, they children come with their parents and they go to sleep, they listen to it, and then go and you know, drink tea or juice, whatever is available, or drink a bottle of water, and this whole thing happens, just imagine, for free, every school. Just imagine what this will do to scientific curiosity. Just imagine we say that, you know, ISRO is launching this, right? Our satellite is doing this. Our forefathers found out that Mars will be red in color. How did they do all this, right? So, and there are amazing stories that can be made available to everyone. In fact, what we are going to do is, we are going to make available this entire project as open source. So anybody can even make it, and it can be made available to every school at a cost of about 1,000 rupees. There are 10 lakh schools in the country, can be made available to everybody. Let all our children learn, let the scientific curiosity come, and so on, we can do fantastic things. So projects such as this are starting point for IoT, right? So we'll be more than happy, we are already working on some of these projects, and we will share them with you. Certainly Arduino thing is going to be on, we have already written a book, Scilab Arduino, in fact we interfaced Arduino from Scilab, Xcos, Python, now Julia. So we are going to, you know, come up with that book soon. Of course you can also download that book from our webpage directly for free. We will make that available. We did this as a part of our FOSSI project, and Internet of Things, also things are happening. Only difference is now all the communication is through internet. That's the only difference. Everything else is the same. We are creating tutorials on Linux. We have a large number of tutorials on Bash, for example. If you want to become good in Linux, you need Bash. First thing people will ask, do you know shell scripting? The answer is yes. If you know, you do spoken tutorials, you know shell scripting, then you become a great fellow. You can do all kinds of things. You can create a cron job, which will at midnight back it up. You can create a mirror. You can do all kinds of fantastic things. So we are into all of that. I'm happy to have more association with people like you, your college, and Linux enthusiasts to work with us.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Apparently, we are way past our break. So I'm going to end the show here. If there are further questions, I'll be more than happy to answer them. Please post them in the discussion section of 8th week. Thank you. Goodbye and